so good to see you today. Trust you are doing well. Glad that you are here today. And as you're finding your seats, grab your bulletin and we'll review a few items this morning. And let me begin by saying congrats to A&M on their victory last night. There you go. I'm. Some of you have noticed I'm sporting one of my two A&M ties, and I wish Ken Price was here. Ken bought me this the last time A&M beat Alabama with Johnny Manziel when A&M came into the SEC. And so that night he said, so if Alabama wins, or if A&M wins, will you wear an A&M tie? And I said, yeah, I've actually got one. I've got an old one that was Brother Fred Dollar's tie, and so I will wear that tomorrow. He says, I'll get you a tie. So, okay. I said, well, you gonna wear something for Alabama if Alabama wins? He said, yeah, yeah, that ain't gonna happen. Well, turns out he was right, and he went and bought me a brand new A&M tie, so I have another occasion to wear it. So congrats to you guys. There's your A&M tie today. So Ken, if you're listening, here you go. Back at you, baby.
Is that for the rest of the year?
This is the first time I've worn a tie in here all year, so I mean, come on, get it right. I mean, I've tightened up a little. Will that work? And good to see Adriana here this morning. If A&M winning gets you to church, then I hope they win the rest of all their games. Glad you're here. All right. Again, if you have your bulletin, let's review a few things. Ladies Bible Study meets again Tuesday, October the 11th at 6 p.m. to eat. Tuesday, October the 12th. How's that? Excuse me. There's a typo there. You are? Are you meeting on Tuesday or Monday?
Monday. Wednesday.
Oh. Do what? It doesn't. I'm just saying that. Are you meeting Monday or Tuesday?
We'll be here tomorrow.
Okay. So it's my fault. I don't know why I had that in my head. So it's right. I'm wrong. You're meeting tomorrow, Monday, October the 11th. So excuse me. I don't know why I had that in my head.
Losing just really messed with your head.
I guess maybe that's it. When you're not used to it, that's what happens, right? Throws you in the loop. All right. So, Ladies Bible Study tomorrow night at 6 p.m. to eat, and then 6:30 for the Bible study. All right, that's all on me. I guess I have Tuesday in mind for the men's prayer meeting, and I guess I had that in my head. So anyway, I'm trying to make an excuse for a bad connection, and that's all I can do.
Ladies Bible Study.
It used to be, right, exactly. So thank you for helping me. There you go. I've got two good excuses. Marcus is now my rep, so. All right. Operation Christmas Child kickoff on the 17th. Don't forget about that. You'll hear more about that next week, and I'm sure Miss Kathy will have a lot to share with us in regards to that. And that is next week, 17th. So. And the Fall Festival, as you all know by now, is on the 30th. That is the Saturday, last Saturday of the month. Which is our practice, our tradition, and we hope that the weather participates. I've noticed that the sign-up sheet out there is filling in. I'm so thankful for that. Appreciate all the help that we already have committed. Remember, if you are signing up for something, you're responsible for that activity. Please make sure you're here early to help set up and to run that event. And if you need something to help that be a success, then let me know. We need to work together to ensure that we are prepared and ready for a great fall festival. I do have some flyers in the foyer if you want to take some of those. And I will also add that if you need more, let me know how many you need or how many you want. As long as you will give them out, I will print them. And if you want to take the responsibility of passing out some of the flyers in the community, if you and your kids want to help me do that, instead of me doing it all, you want to help me, I will be glad to assign you some areas, some segments, and give you the flyers and send you out with blessings. And so if you want to help in that regard, I certainly welcome that and appreciate any assistance we can get in getting the word out into our community. That is essential. And by the way, there is a little bit of a typo. Again, this is back on me. You notice that the sign last week said 11 to 2. The bulletin says 11 to 2. I had announced 11 to 2. And we had switched from 11 to 2, I think last year, maybe the year before, something like that, to 11 till 1. And so I apologize for the confusion that that has caused, but that means it's a shorter window for your commitment. So our fall festival is from 11 a.m. to 1 p.m., not 2 p.m. So you can change that in your bulletin. I know it says 2, but it's supposed to be 1. And the sign out front has been changed, and the flyers reflect that as well. So if you have questions about that, let me know. But what that means is just that much less of a commitment on your part, and hopefully that much less heat that we will deal with that day. But please help us make that a great success. And then the following day, the 31st, is our meal of the month, and that is our chili cook-off. We ask you to be preparing your favorite chili recipe, and let's come together and see who has the favored chili of the year. So we're looking forward to that. And again, our guest speaker that day is Josh Provo. We're looking forward to him being with us in our morning service. And so please come and participate and be ready to pray for, support, and give to the Provos. And certainly looking forward to what God is going to continue to do in their ministry. Let me also encourage our men and remind you about the two prayer opportunities. Of course, you can pray anytime, all the time, and we hope that you do pray more than just these two times. But we have organized prayer time for the men between Sunday school and Sunday morning worship. And then on Tuesday mornings at 9 a.m., we invite any and all men to come and to participate in that prayer time. It's a wonderful time for us to get together and to bless you, encourage one another, and share together, and then pray for these needs. And there are always lots of needs for us to pray about. Hope that you will participate. Are you glad to be here this morning?
Yeah.
All right, good. Let me ask you to stand, and we'll go to the Lord in prayer today. Let's pray. Lord, thank you so much for the day that you have given us. Thank you for these that are here this morning in our service. Thank you for the opportunity and the privilege that it is, Lord, to fellowship with one another, to lift our voices, and to worship you, and to study the living Word of God. What a great series that we've had in our Sunday school classes, our Sunday school hour. I'm so thankful for all of our Sunday school teachers. I pray a very special blessing on them today. I pray, God, that you would encourage them and help them to continue, and Lord, not to grow weary in well-doing. Lord, help them to be faithful to you and the cause that you have given them. And Lord, I pray that you would help us as a church to support them by being involved in our Sunday school, letting them know that we care about them and the effort that they're putting in by participating in our Sunday school hour. And I pray, God, you just help us to continue to grow in that endeavor. And Lord, help us to see your blessings and the outpouring of your Spirit and the change that you bring in our lives as we study your Word. God, I pray that as we concentrate this morning on the remainder of our time, as we give in our offering, as we give in our offerings of praise, and as we give in attention, as we study your Word, I pray, Lord, that you would bless this time. I pray that it would all be for your honor and glory. I pray that you and you alone would be exalted. And God, I pray that everything we do and say here today would please you. God, I pray that you would remove any distractions and hindrances in our minds and in our lives. And I pray, God, that if there's anyone that's involved in any aspect of this service that has any secret agenda, God, that's different than glorifying and exalting you, I pray, Lord, that that would change even now. And I pray, Lord, that you would be the center of our attention, the center of our focus, and the center of our hearts. And God, may you be pleased in all that is done today. We give you thanks and pray in Jesus' name. Amen. Amen. Please be seated.
Good to see you this morning. We're going to begin with number 514 in the hymnal as we sing about sharing, sharing the Spirit, sharing God's Word with one another, and being involved in His Word. 514, I want to be a worker.
I want to be a worker for the Lord. I want to love and trust His holy word. I want to sing and pray beneath the empty air.
We're going over to number 525. 525, little is much when God is in it. We'll sing all three first.
In the harvest field now ripen, there's a word for all to drink. Hark, the voice of God is calling to the harvest, calling you.
To give to people, and I think we need to give them to people that come here. Yes. And I should have let Loretta do this report because I don't know how to say the name of this church. It's in Chitre, Panama, and they passed out New Testaments at the traffic light on the corner of their church. Cirilo Mendoza is the pastor. Y'all pray for the churches in Panama. This is their church building. Isn't that pretty? They are enthusiastic. We could learn a lot from them. They're excited about what they do. They do a lot of activities, and this is one that really touched my heart. I want us to do that. Let's pray. Father, thank you so much for the ability to know what's going on around the world. I know there's a lot of bad things on the internet, but there's so much good that we can use. And we thank you for that, the way that these churches around the world touch our hearts and make us want to do more for you, reach more people for you. Father, use us to the best of our abilities through your power to reach people. We want everybody to have a Bible and to have that word in their lives, in their homes, so that when they see it, your Holy Spirit speaks to them about it. We thank you, Father, in Jesus' name, amen.
Amen. That was a great lead-in to our final song. I ask you to stand, number 524, Freely, Freely. We are are asked to give freely, freely. Number 524. We'll sing both verses.
God forgive my sin in Jesus' name. I've been born again in Jesus' name. And in Jesus' name I come to you to share His love as He told me to. He said, freely, freely you have received. Freely, freely give. Oh, in my name and He was to relieve. Others will know that I live.
song is in the book.
I titled the message this morning, Quit Quenching the Spirit. Quit Quenching the Spirit. Read with me, if you will, beginning in verse 12. Now we ask you, brothers and sisters, to give recognition to those who labor among you and lead you in the Lord and admonish you, and to regard them very highly in love because of their work. Be at peace among yourselves. And we exhort you, brothers and sisters, warn those who are idle, comfort the discouraged, help the weak, be patient with everyone. See to it that no one repays evil for evil to anyone, but always pursue what is good for one another and for all. You know, we could stop right there and we could preach a whole series. There's some really good practical advice that Paul is giving in these verses in how to live out the Christian faith. That it's more than just going to church and hearing a good message, saying amen, and then going out and doing your thing all week long, come back to church and hearing a good message and saying amen, and your life not being changed. That's not the purpose that God intends for us to go to church. Amen. It's not just that we be intellectually stimulated. It's not that we just be inspired by a good song. All those things are important aspects, but there's so much more that God intends. And what we see in Paul's teaching and preaching and in these letters to the Thessalonian believers is he's constantly spurring them on to put into practice the transformation that God desires to work and to accomplish in our lives. And so therefore it affects every aspect of our living. So much so as to recognizing those who serve and lead, and you respect those and appreciate those, all the way down to living at peace with one another, not being idle, not being lazy. And boy, that's a problem in our world today. You ever notice, by the way, how many places around here are looking for help? You ever wonder why? I can tell you a lot of the reason why is because there's a lot of idle people. They're living off of somebody else's labor. And I did say that, yes. And that's a problem. There's a lot of idleness. And Paul encourages them not to put up with it. Don't tolerate it in the church. And you heard me say, and I've said it many times, not just in this text and in this study, there is no place for idleness or laziness with a Christian. Amen. No Christian should be lazy. We ought to be the hardest workers there are around. We may not be the smartest. We may not be the best. We might be, but we may not be. But we ought to be the hardest workers. And that ought to be for certain. But it goes on, as he says here, about helping one another, helping the weak, and being patient with one another, even down to how we respond when somebody wrongs us. And let's face it, every one of us, when someone does us wrong, we want to get even. We want to show them. We want to teach them. I'll fix you. That's not the way that God would have us to respond. You see, the truth is we are to respond from the nature within that God is working in us, and not the old sinful nature that is to protect ourselves and our own selfish interests. And that's what Paul is demonstrating here. So there's this practical application in everyday life that he gives in this text. And he even transitions from that to, boy, how this affects your whole perspective and your outlook on life. Not just how you relate to one another and put into practice these teachings and the transformation God's doing in your life, but how you look at everything. Because look at what he says, rejoice always. Now, I want to tell you what, there are a lot of people driving around with bumper stickers that reflect that they are following Jesus, that Jesus is their pilot or their co-pilot. And if Jesus is their co-pilot, I want to get out of their way anyway. Amen? And they got all kinds of t-shirts and all that stuff. And some of them, I wish they would burn it. Because they are not, you hear what I'm saying? They're not representing Him well. And some people walking around calling themselves Christians and trying to be supposed believers impacting their world are some of the grouchiest, nastiest, negative people in the world. What a shame. And that is contrary to what Paul says in the middle of this text, because he says, rejoice always. Can I tell you something? It's awful hard to rejoice when you're sour. It's hard to rejoice when you got a frown on your face and you look like somebody's sucking the juice out of your toes. Now, I don't know where that came from, but I'm just saying, come on, people. We have every reason in the world to be joyful. And yet we walk around with a prune face look on. What is up with us? You see what I mean by Paul goes from practical application and living out the Christian life to even how that it affects your perspective on life, your outlook on everything, because he says rejoice always. Even after your team loses? Yeah. Even after somebody cuts you off on the road? Yeah. Oh, wait, I went there too, didn't I? Even after your wife burns the food? Yeah. And even after your husband makes a mess in the den? Yeah. I mean, we can go on and on. Rejoice always. Amen?
Amen.
Why should we rejoice always? Because the Spirit of God lives within us. And the work that God is doing in us is far greater than all of these peripheral things that often we concentrate on and get blinded by. You see, that's why he says that it affects our whole outlook on life. Oh, he's not done. Pray constantly. And I'm afraid that many people pray when they come to church, and that's about the prayer that they get all week long. And maybe, you know, thank you, Lord, for the food. Amen. Let's hurry up and eat so we can go watch our TV show. Pray constantly. We ought to all, you know what? Prayer services ought to be something that we embrace and enjoy because it's an overflow of what we already are living. But for far too many, we're uncomfortable in a time of prayer, and we're uncomfortable when we get called on in public prayer because we spend so little time personally in prayer. It continues. Verse 18, give thanks in everything. Aren't you glad, by the way, he said in everything and not for everything. We've talked about that too, right? And we can give thanks in every situation. For this is, what's that say? God's will for you in Christ Jesus. You know, there are some things we don't know about what God's will is. Whether I buy a blue car, a green car, or a red car. Whether I eat Chinese or Mexican. You know, whether I let my hair grow out or I cut it short. You know, some of these things that are left for us to decide. We may not know God's will, and I think God gives us discernment about certain things. But there are some things for sure, the Bible says, are clear cut God's will for your life. And those are things we ought to really pay attention to, right? We can know that for sure. And it's God's will that you give thanks in everything. And so if you're having a hard time giving thanks, you ought to pray and ask God, Lord, change my heart. Help me to be thankful so I can do what you've already told me to do. I can be who you're calling me to be. Verse 19, don't stifle the Spirit. That's where the text or the title, excuse me, for our sermon has come from if you haven't already figured it out. In the King James Version, it uses quench the Spirit, I believe. Don't despise prophecies, but test all things. I love that, by the way. Test all things. Not just what the preacher says, but that does include what the preacher says. Amen? We ought to test everything. And you know what? I'm afraid that so many people in our world that do, they test only the things that they think are real important. But I believe as believers, everything's important. And that's why the Word of God says test all things, which means the music that we listen to and shows that we watch and the places that we go and the things that we take into our body, the things that come out of our body and the people that we hang out with. I think all of those things, I think for a believer, is important. And I think we're foolish. Can I say this again? We are a fool if we think we can be a child of God and live a life that pleases God and not test all things. You're kidding yourself. You're playing church. You're not being the church. Now, I'm getting preachy already. We're still reading the text. Y'all bear with me now. We're not done. Test all things. Hold on to that which is good. How can you know what is good and how can you cling to or hold what is good if you haven't tested to see if it was good? You're just clinging to what feels good. You just cling to what you like. Amen. Praise God. If I like it, I'm going to do it. That's the way that most of us are. And we never test it as long as it's what I like. And what we should do is look at it and say, okay, I like it, I know that, but does it meet the standard? Does it measure up? Does God approve of it? If God doesn't approve of it, it doesn't matter whether I like it or not, it probably ought not be a part of my life. So hold to that which is good and stay away from every kind of evil. Can everybody say that last verse with me?
Stay
away from every kind of evil. You know what? Can I just say this? You and I would save ourselves and our family tons of grief if we just apply that one rule. Now, I didn't talk about all the others, and some of that's good, and some of it's hard. But if we just applied that one rule, we'd save ourselves a lot of grief. Don't you know that? Do you not understand that what God is doing in His Word, what the Holy Spirit tries to do in our lives, is not to make us miserable, but to make us better? You see, God is working through the Spirit to accomplish within us the kingdom of God, and so that we can experience the best of God. And yet we so often settle for so less, because we misunderstand and misinterpret God's intentions for our lives. And somehow we get this misconception that God is trying to hold out on us. God's just trying to maybe make us miserable in some way or another. And to be a Christian, you've got to be miserable about something. Well, we should be, and it should be sin. And it should be that we are not following God the way that we ought to. That's what we ought to be miserable about. Amen, church?
Yeah.
Man, that's a lot of good stuff. All right, so let's dig in here. What do we see in this text? If you haven't already noticed, what I'm trying to highlight and concentrate on is the work of the Holy Spirit in our life. What we need to see is that what God wants to do is just not for us to read God's Word and do what we think is good. Do what we think is right. What we ought to do is to read the Word of God and allow the Holy Spirit to help that Word come to life. And we let the Holy Spirit to guide us in every aspect of our lives. Yes, every aspect of our lives.
Yeah.
That's what God desires to do for us. That's why the Bible says that we are the temple of God and that the Holy Spirit indwells us. Well, we're going to come to some of that in this service this morning. So, quit quenching the Spirit is what Paul says to the Thessalonian believers and what I want us to focus on in this text today. First of all, what you see that the Holy Spirit, and we'll get there in just a minute, Lydia. Just hold right there. I know you're ready. We'll get to these things in just a moment, but I want you to hear this. The Holy Spirit is the agent by which that the Heavenly Father draws us to Him. The Holy Spirit indwells every believer. The Holy Spirit sanctifies us or sets us apart and makes us holy. It is the Holy Spirit that strengthens us. It is the Holy Spirit that is the force that drives ministry in the kingdom of God. It's the Holy Spirit that gives us boldness to speak out and to live out the truth of the Word of God. It is what Paul says in this text. It is why Paul says in this text. It's so important for us to hear as believers individually and collectively. He says, quit quenching the Spirit. Because in essence, when you and I quench the Spirit, even in small ways, what we do is we hinder or prevent or restrict the work of God, the power of God, and the will of God in our lives and in the ministry. Would you agree with that?
Amen.
So the combination in our text, as one writer said, of a negative particle with the present imperative suggests that the recipients are being told to stop doing something they have already begun. So in other words, what he's saying is that Paul is addressing a struggle apparently going on in the Thessalonian church. There were some things that they were doing that was quenching the Spirit. So he's not just giving instruction for future ministry and for future development. He's addressing a very present need in their present situation. He says the command could be paraphrased something like this: stop putting out the fire of the Holy Spirit. Stop hindering and repressing the Holy Spirit. For in so doing, you are preventing Him from exerting his full influence. And as you and I may already know, there's a similar warning that Paul gives in Ephesians 4, 29 and 30, where Paul says, no foul language should come from your mouth. Up, some of us are already in trouble. Amen. Right there. Boy, we're getting quiet in here this morning. Amen. It didn't say some foul language should come from our mouth. What was that big two-letter word? No. Foul language. No foul language. Well, you don't understand. You'd be surprised what I understand. I understand a lot, and I understand how quick we are to justify and rationalize, and I understand how good we are at making excuses, and I also understand about the grip that vulgarity has in a man's heart, and even in women as well. Because as a teenager, and some of you have heard me say this, I guarantee you I could cuss with the worst or the best of them, however you want to say it. And I would have said some things that would shock your ears. And some of you who hear me and know me say, that's not true, there's no way. I'm thankful you don't know how I used to be. And I'm thankful I'm not how and who I used to be. That's the work of God in me. But I want to tell you, there was a time in my Christian walk where I struggled. And it was hard when certain situations and issues came up not to spout out expletives that had been such a part of my life growing up. And I had so embraced. It was a struggle. No, it was a real battle. And I felt so dirty and so guilty at the end of the day. And I realized this was a big issue. And I didn't want to grow up that way. And I didn't want to be that person. And I sure didn't want to raise a family that way. And I am thankful to say, not because of me and myself, but the work of God. My children have never heard me say even the slightest foul language. Not the slightest foul word.
Amen.
And that's a testimony to the work of God. And you know what I've learned to do? I prayed, I got on my knees and I prayed regularly and I committed myself to memorizing certain scripture because I understood that the only way I was going to get victory over this is if the Spirit of God changed my heart. Because the Bible says from the abundance of the heart the mouth speaks. And what I learned was if it wasn't in my heart, it couldn't come out of my mouth. And that's the only way you're going to get victory too. If you're struggling with it, that's the only way you will get victory. So he says, no foul language should come from your mouth, but only what is good for building up someone in need, so that it gives grace to those who hear. And grieve not, or don't grieve God's Holy Spirit. You understand what Paul's saying right there? Do you understand that, listen, he is connecting grieving the Spirit with saying things that either help or hurt people. In other words, if you are using foul language, listen to me. It doesn't matter how young you are, how old you are. It doesn't matter what your gender. It doesn't matter what your excuses. If you're using foul language, please hear the connection. You are grieving the Spirit of God.
Yeah.
Well, you don't know my culture. I don't need to know. And you'd be surprised at what I have understood and experienced. But the truth of God's Word is you and I grieve the Spirit of God when we use vulgarity and our words are not for the benefit or the building up of others. He says, you were sealed by Him. That is the Holy Spirit. And He says, don't grieve the Holy Spirit. Clear instructions. That's one of the guaranteed ways that you and I, it doesn't matter what position, what title, who you are, what you've done and accomplished, and how involved you are in ministry or service, you grieve the Holy Spirit right there with the words that come out of your mouth. You understand that? That's powerful. That's impactful. That means that we are responsible for what we say. Amen? You understand?
Amen.
All right. Let me share with you what some commentators say about the subject of quenching the Spirit. I'm building, okay, a platform, a foundation, and then we'll launch here in just a moment. We've got to get rolling. All right. So, Lydia, if you're ready, that first one, Adam Clark's commentary says, the Holy Spirit is represented as a fire because it is His province to enlighten and quicken the soul and to purge, purify, and refine it. This Spirit represented as being quenched when at any act is done, when any act is done, word spoken or temper indulged, contrary to its dictates. In other words, let me paraphrase what he said right there. Anytime we say or do something that is contrary to the Spirit of God, to the word of God or the will of God, what he's saying is that quenches the spirit. That's pretty simple. You understand that? That's not confounding. It is the spirit of love, and therefore anger, malice, revenge, or any unkind or unholy temper will quench it so that it will withdraw its influences, and then the heart is left in a state of hardness and darkness. You know, sometimes we see people who are even children of God, even men of God, leaders of God, and we say, how could they say such a thing? How could they do such a thing? One of the guaranteed ways you can get to that point is by quenching the Spirit. Doing things that quench the Spirit, and then the Spirit withdraws from you. And as he says, then you have that state of that hard-heartedness and darkness that pervades your heart. That's a sobering reality. Men, women, that is a sobering reality that we could do such things that we would cause the Spirit of God to withdraw from us. Does that not alarm you? It does me. And it should every one of us. Barnes, commentary, next. Lydia says, the sense is, we are not to extinguish the influences of the Holy Spirit in our hearts. Possibly there may be an allusion here to fire on an altar, which was to be kept constantly burning. Picture that. This fire may have been regarded as emblematic of devotion, and as denoting that that devotion was never to become extinct. In other words, you guard it, you protect it, don't ever let it dwindle. The Holy Spirit is the source of the true devotion, and hence the enkindlings of piety in the heart by the Spirit are never to be quenched. Fire, he continues, must be nourished with proper care and attention. You understand what he's saying? What he's saying is you've got to guard that the Holy Spirit is always welcome in your heart, and you do absolutely nothing to hinder His work and His freedom in your heart and in your life. You've got to guard it. You've got to be intentional. You've got to take care of it and not allow that fire to go down. Interesting. You know, if you build a campfire, Dust, I know you like to camp. Some of you others like to camp, or maybe have a fire in the house. Not in the house, but in the house, in the fireplace. And you know the natural tendency of things, if you just let it burn, eventually it's going to burn out. But what you have to do is you have to poke that fire every once in a while. You have to prod that fire. You have to turn those coals. And you have to throw some more fuel on the fire. Hopefully you're not dumb enough to throw gas or diesel on the fire. If you are, you get what you deserve. But that's another story for another day. Okay? No, anyway. But you gotta add fuel to that fire. You gotta put some more wood or substance to burn on there to keep that fire going. That's what he's talking about right there, caring for that fire. You have to be intentional with the Holy Spirit in your life to take care, not only to not let that fire burn out, but not to cause that fire to burn out. You get the picture? It's important. David Jeremiah said this, you quench the Spirit, or the Holy Spirit, by not doing something He tells you to do. When you walk in the Spirit and are filled with the Spirit, you don't want to quench Him. And when He tells you to do something, guess what? Surprise! You do it. You know what he's saying? This is so simple. Let's say you're in a church service like this. Let's say there's an invitation time. And let's say that the Holy Spirit prods you. Hey, you need to go down there and pray. And you know what we do? I'll pray right here. I'll pray later. I know I'm not the only one that's ever done that. Amen? Or, say for example, you're standing in a line somewhere and the Holy Spirit says, hey, you want to speak to them about Jesus? You sure you're talking to me? Not now. Not here. Really? When the Holy Spirit speaks to you, guess what He says you should do? Do it. You think the Holy Spirit speaks to us just so we can resist? just so he can show up and we can, oh, I'm glad you're there. I'm not listening to you, but glad you're there. And then that doesn't change our situation and it doesn't change our relationship. No. What we need to understand is when you say no, and how do you say no? By not obeying. By not instantly, completely, entirely, and immediately obeying, you say no to the Holy Spirit. I would never say no to God, but that's what you do when you don't say yes.
Right.
When you don't obey the Spirit of God, you are saying no to the Spirit of God, and you are quenching the Spirit in your life. J. Vernon McGee writes, "To quench the Spirit means that you refuse to do the will of God. That is, you are not listening to the Holy Spirit. You refuse to let the Holy Spirit be your guide to lead you. You and I quench the Holy Spirit when we take matters into our own hands." And I'm sure none of us ever do that, right? So insightful. Vine's commentary says this, "The peace, order, and edification of the saints were evidence of the ministry of the Spirit among them. But if, through ignorance of His ways, or through failure to recognize or refusal to submit to them, or through impatience with the ignorance of self-will of others, the Spirit were quenched, these happy results would be absent." In other words, if you don't listen, whether it's just out of ignorance or willful disobedience and defiance, and not aware of the Spirit of God wanting to work through you and work in other people, and you refuse to listen to the Spirit of God, then the obvious results of what the Spirit of God would do can't be done.
Right.
You're holding back or quenching the power of God and the Spirit to work in you and through you. He continues, "For there was always the danger that the impulses of the flesh might usurp the place of the energy of the Spirit in the assembly, and the endeavor to restrain this evil by nature or by natural means would have the effect of hindering His ministry also." Man, such good insight. And what we have got to understand with these commentaries, and I've got one more to share with you, one more quote, is that there's a great impetus upon us to take care of and to guard our hearts in that we are ever so sensitive and obedient to the Spirit of God and not doing anything that would hinder the Spirit of God lest we drift farther away and therefore not hear and allow the Spirit of God to work in our lives. Woodrow Crowe said, "When we fail to yield ourselves completely to Him, we quench the Holy Spirit." Now, do you know what it means to quench the Spirit of God? It doesn't mean that we extinguish Him as you would quench or extinguish a fire. It means that we stifle Him. We stifle His influence in our lives. In other words, we are not stronger than God. We are not stronger than the Holy Spirit, but what we do when we quench the Spirit is we harden our heart and we resist from hearing His voice. And we resist and stiffen ourselves to obedience to Him. That's what it is. In other words, we hurt ourselves and we hinder the free-flowing Spirit of God and the power of God in our life when we resist Him. In the small things, and the small things, by the way, lead to the big things.
Yeah.
You don't have a major catastrophical failure in a Christian's walk in life until you fail in the little things to listen to the Spirit of God. You get to the major collapse because you fail to listen in the little areas of your life. Well, we need to jump in here now. That's all foundational stuff, and the rest is going to go quickly, believe it or not, okay? So here we go. We're talking about quit quenching the Spirit of God. Point number one, quit repaying evil for evil. That's what Paul said in our text. You notice that in verse 15? Paul said, quit repaying evil for evil. What did Jesus say in Matthew 5:44 in reference to those who despitefully use us and those who are our enemies? Does anybody remember? Jesus said to pray for them and to love your enemies. You see what Paul's instruction in the practical sense in this text and living out the Christian life in everyday interrelational situations when he says, as quit repaying evil for evil, is what he is doing is putting into practice what Jesus has already taught, and that is to embrace your enemy, love your enemy, and pray for them. And I'm going to tell you what, it's kind of hard for you to repay somebody when they do you wrong if you're praying for them and if you love them. Because if you love them and are praying for them, you want God to work in their life. You don't want them to get what they deserve because, thank God, you ain't getting what you deserve. And so you love them and you want God's best for them, so you don't want to heap coals upon their head in the sense of misery. You want the blessings of God in their life. And you want to see them experience the power and the presence of God. You see, that's the work that God does, as long as we are following the Spirit of God and not our flesh. Number two, quit refusing to give thanks. Well, we talked about that, but Paul says that in verse 18. You understand that one of the greatest hindrances or one of the greatest ways that we quench the Spirit is by complaining? Let me put it in a more positive way. If you and I would learn to be thankful, we would open the door so that we would hear more of the voice of God and His Spirit in our lives. And when we refuse to be grateful, and by the way, Thanksgiving is coming up and we'll have an opportunity, hopefully, to share a testimony of gratefulness and thanksgiving. But it ought to be that at any moment, at any place, and at any time, any child of God, even in the most dire of situations, ought to be able to give thanks to God. Yes. Do you understand how blessed we are in this country? Do you understand how good it is, even as bad as things are politically and how chaotic and crazy things are in our world right now? And I know gas keeps going up, and I know food keeps going up, and everything keeps going up except for our income. Amen? But you know what? We still have much to be thankful for. Amen. Daniel was jokingly telling me he heard somebody say that Brother Doug was probably not feeling too good or not doing too good because his team lost yesterday. And if that's all it took to get me down, I'd feel pretty sorry for myself. I mean, you know what? I mean, I'm pulling for my team, but it's done, it's over with, and that's not the end of the world. I got so many other good things to be thankful for, don't you? My life doesn't revolve around that game. I enjoy it, but there's so much more that we have to be thankful for. And when you and I refuse to be thankful, we quench the Spirit. Or let me put it another way. When you choose to grumble and complain about your boss, your coworkers, your family, your situation, your friends, whatever it is, and you choose to grumble and complain about it, just remember, you right then and there are quenching the Spirit of God in your life. I bet you never thought about that, have you? Well, I'm just dealing with what I've got to deal with. And you're dealing with it in a way that doesn't honor God, and you're quenching the Spirit. And so don't be surprised when there's that natural decline, and when you find yourself drifting farther away from God and not as close to God, and you don't have that peace, and you're not filled with joy. Why? Because you can't be joyful and complaining at the same time. Just like you can't be fearful and victorious at the same time, you can't be complaining and filled with the joy of the Lord. We could make so many applications to that. In Isaiah 63:10, we read, "But they rebelled and grieved His Holy Spirit, so He became their enemy and fought against them." You know what Isaiah is talking about in that text? This is part of that time where Isaiah is giving a time of prayer, and Isaiah is reflecting on the moments of rebellion and defiance and disobedience by the children of God. Even though God had blessed them and God had worked so many miracles in their lives, and guess what they did? You know the story. Grumble and complain. God gave them manna, but it wasn't enough. God gave them quail, wasn't enough. God gave them water, wasn't enough. This sounds like us in America today, doesn't it? We got it so good, and yet it's never good enough. And grumble and complain is what we do. And listen what that text said. It says, so they grieve His Spirit. Even in the Old Testament, they're complaining and they're their negativity, their lack of gratefulness, because God had done so much and been so good to them, it grieved the Holy Spirit. Even though the Holy Spirit didn't indwell them, it still grieved him. And it says he, when it says so, that means their actions had an absolute automatic reaction by God, or it led to God doing certain things and becoming a certain way. It says, so he became their enemy and he fought against them. I want you to understand that as a child of God, you are favored, you are loved, and God wants the best for you. But you need to understand that when you start grieving the Spirit, you are not only experiencing God's best, you are not. You're missing out on it. And you are causing yourself to go in the opposite direction away from God. And the last thing you want to do is reach this point where God turns against you because you have so grieved His Spirit that not only is He not for you, but He's against you and He becomes your enemy. That's not a place to be. And you look at the history of the nation of Israel and you look at the misery that they brought on themselves when they could have experienced such wonderful blessings, such victory, unparalleled. And they robbed themselves simply because they grieved the Holy Spirit. And I wonder, church, I wonder today how many of us are in miserable places and we're dealing with great discomfort and misery in our lives because we have been grieving the Holy Spirit. And there's many ways that we do that. We've already tuned into several of those in our text today. Number three, quit resisting the will of God. Quit resisting the will of God. In verse 18 in our text, you remember what Paul said? Remember he said, give thanks in everything, for this is God's will. Remember we focused on that when we read the text. And so we are resisting the will of God when we do not give thanks in everything. In Acts chapter 7, verse 51, we read, you stubborn people, you are heathen at heart and deaf to the truth. Must you forever resist the Holy Spirit? That's what your ancestors did, and so do you. Man, what a powerful word. What an indictment against people who were the chosen ones, the family of God, and they resisted the Holy Spirit. They followed their father's examples. Men, let me say to you, one of the greatest responsibilities that you have in the home is teaching your children to listen to God and to follow Him and not resist or quench the Spirit. And please understand, you can say, let's go to church and listen to your teacher and what did they say? And you can say all that you want to, but if your actions are not enforcing that at home, then please understand they will much more likely follow your practices than your words. And one of the most futile things that a parent can say is, do what I say, not what I do. So quit resisting the will of God. We wonder sometimes why our children are so unhappy, why nothing satisfies them, why they're always complaining. Maybe we need to look in the mirror. Maybe we're not modeling an attitude of gratitude ourselves. Number four, quit rejecting the Word of God. Look at verse 22 again. He says, stay away from every kind of evil. Do you understand that when you and I do the direct opposite of what God's Word says for us to do, that we are disobeying God's Word? We say to you, God, your Word doesn't matter. Your will doesn't matter. I'm going to do what I want to. I'm going to be my God. Sounds a whole lot like what Satan tempted Eve with back in the Garden of Eden, right? And we still have that same struggle today. You know, the truth is God's Word is black and white. Actually, the letters are black and the pages are white. And it's pretty simple. You know why? Because it's black and white. There's no gray area. We always want to talk about the gray area. God's Word's pretty clear. And there are some certainties in God's Word. And you know what we like to do? Well, that's all right for you. That's all right for them. And that was back then. And we don't really want to put into practice all that God says for us today. And we disobey God's word. And listen to me, church. When you are in direct disobedience to God's word, you are quenching the Spirit in your life and in your home and in the church. Can I say that again? It doesn't matter which word of God, which directive from God's word you are being disobedient to, you are quenching the Spirit in your life, in your home, and in your church. That's clear instruction right here from God's word. I don't know about you, but I want the Spirit of God to move freely in our services. I want us to come to church and experience an outpouring of the Spirit of God, and people respond, and people pray, and lives are changed, decisions are made, and people are growing, and people are going. I want to see that. I'm afraid so often we hinder that because of our disobedience to His Word. But not only do I want to see it here, I want to see it in my life. I want the Spirit of God to freely speak to me and guide me and direct me to say, go over there and talk to this person and do this and do that. And I want to obey in every one of those situations immediately. You know what? I don't always do it. And we quench the Spirit when that's our response. So we looked at the negative on the quitting. Let me give you three quick positives. So instead of these things, what we need to do first, number one, is start listening to the Holy Spirit. You don't want to quench the Spirit, you need to listen to the Spirit. Psalm 51, in that whole psalm, I encourage you to read it. But in that psalm, David says in verse 11, do not banish me from your presence. Don't take your Holy Spirit from me. Man, I sing that part of that song and that psalm almost every morning. Almost every morning. Why? Because I want to guard against. I want to take care of that fire. I want to put fuel on the fire. I don't want to take the fire away. I want to create, and I want to make sure that I'm doing all that I can to provide an atmosphere and an opportunity for the Spirit of God to move and to work in me freely. And so that begins by listening to the Holy Spirit. And when He speaks, you need to obey. You need to listen to Him. And that's the second one, and that is obey the Holy Spirit. Not only listen, but obey. How many times do we listen and we hear, and it's not what we want to hear, so thanks, but no thanks. And we expect our children to obey, but we don't do any more obeying ourselves. So it's not only important that you hear the Holy Spirit, but listen, let me promise you, if you're not obeying the Holy Spirit, it won't be long and you won't be hearing the Holy Spirit. Can I say that again? If you're not faithfully obeying the Holy Spirit, it won't be long and you won't be hearing the Holy Spirit. And finally, number three, start seeking the things of God. Well, Paul said that in verse 20, 21, and 22. Verse 20, don't despise the prophecies. 21 is to abstain from all things that are evil. Cling to that which is good. And then, of course, verse 22, stay away from everything that's evil. So seek the things of God. It ought to be that as a Christian, we ought to desire to be here at God's house with God's people, worshiping Him and studying His Word. But you know, the truth is, in a lot of people's lives and a lot of Christians' lives, it's a struggle to go to church. It's a struggle to be here. It's a struggle to make time for that. It's all about perspective. And a lot of it has to do with they've wandered so far, they've disobeyed for so long, they've quenched the Spirit for far too long. Then that heart becomes hardened. And they're not hearing the Spirit of God, so they don't desire the things of God. In Ephesians 4:30, Paul says, and do not bring sorrow to God's Holy Spirit by the way you live. Remember, He has identified you as His own, guaranteeing that you will be saved on the day of redemption. So guard against your life hindering the Spirit. In conclusion, I read a story about two young women whose lives were lost in a fire. a fire that swept through their apartment while they were sleeping, much like the fire that threatened Doug's life a little over a year ago and all of the occupants in his residence as well. Upon investigation, they realized that their home, their apartment, was equipped with a smoke detector, and it was in good working order, but the battery had been disconnected from the smoke detector. It had been deactivated because of a party the night before. And because of the cooking and the candles, they didn't want the alarm to continue going off, so they took the power from their smoke detector. So the very device that could have potentially saved their life when the apartment caught fire was of no use because there was no power. And church, I am saying to us and to you this morning that the very source of God's power to preserve you and to protect you and to guide you and to help you is the Holy Spirit of God. And I'm afraid that if we're not careful, we, like that those couple, can pull that source of power by quenching the Spirit in our lives. And then we'll find ourselves going down in flames. And that's a sad place to be. We need to realize that the Holy Spirit was not given to annoy us like some sensitive smoke alarm, but was given to help us, to protect us.
Amen.
To direct us. Let's guard children of God from quenching the Spirit in our lives. Let's pray. Father, thank you today for your word. I know this text that we looked at today deals with a lot of issues, but the overwhelming, overriding truth is this very important, pressing point about the interaction of us as believers and the Holy Spirit in our lives. And that's the tool, the source, the agent by which, Lord, you work in us. You guide us. You draw us. You direct us. You convict us. You teach us. You help us. You sustain us. You sanctify us through the Holy Spirit. In truth, Lord, our lives are hopeless and empty, void of joy and purpose and meaning without the Holy Spirit. And unfortunately, Lord, as your word teaches, we so often doom ourselves by quenching your work in our lives. I pray, God, that you would take these words today from our text and from this message and that you would penetrate our lives. I pray, God, that that Holy Spirit would move freely in this service and that you, O Lord, would convict us where need to be. And I pray that you would bring us to a point, a turning point in our lives where we will surrender ourselves, commit to you, confess our brokenness, and determine, O Lord, going forward to live in direct obedience to you and to guard against ever quenching the Spirit in our lives in the future. Lord, may you work mightily in these closing moments and in the song of invitation. May your Spirit move freely, we pray in Jesus' name. Amen. Would you stand, please? Marcus has a song of invitation. In a spirit of prayer, would you humbly listen to him?
Open my eyes that I may see glimpses of truth thou hast for me. Place in my hands the wonderful key that shall unclasp and set me free. Silently now I wait for thee. Ready, my God, your will to see. Open my eyes. Spirit divine.
light of the Word of God this morning, maybe today the Spirit of God is ministering to you. Maybe there's some conviction going on. Listen, for a moment, could you forget about the person beside you, even if it's your family member? Can you forget about the person behind you and in front of you and just listen intently to the Spirit of God? Whether He's convicting you about an attitude, whether He's convicting you about your words, whether it's a behavior, whatever it is, and you realize this morning that there are some things that you've done that you know have quenched the Spirit in your life, and you don't want that to continue. If the Spirit of God is dealing with you, and I know He is with some this morning, would you respond in obedience? Step out. Listen, start right now by obeying Him. Come to this altar and give Him this moment, and you will never regret it. But if you refuse the Spirit, you will walk out of here not knowing what could have been, what the Spirit of God wants to do with you today. Would you come?
Open my ears that I may hear voices of truth Thou sendest clear. And while the wave notes fall on my ear, everything false will disappear. Silently now I wait for Thee. Ready, my God, Your will to see. Open my ears, illumine me. Spirit divine.
Thank you so much for your attention today. Brother Daniel, would you dismiss us in prayer?
Heavenly Father, I want to thank you personally for this particular message. Holy Spirit has always been something of a mystery. I've always known about the advocate or the counselor as Jesus referred to when He was getting ready to die on that cross, and He was going to ask His Father to leave the advocate or His counselor to remain there with us. And I've always chased the Holy Spirit, not fully understanding what I was chasing, because we learn a lot about what you're about. We learn a lot about what Jesus wants and expects from us. But there's not really a whole lot about the Holy Spirit itself. And the things we do know, He gives gifts, but you do not want to quench them. I tried to do that myself. I admit that in front of all my brothers and sisters. There's a time in my life where I actually ask the Spirit of God. I demanded the Spirit of God to lead me. I was done. I had no more. I beg for you to withdraw Him from me. And if you ever want to test God in this manner, I suggest that you never, never do this, because you will. I promise you, and I don't make promises. I promise you will go there. Thank you, Father, for giving me. I know there was a time when both Marcus and Brother Doug came to my house, and we talked about this very thing. I never, ever, ever, and I've said this again in front of my brothers and sisters, this time in the opposite direction, I never, ever, ever again want to lose your Holy Spirit. I pray for the complete opposite, Father. I pray that you would give me as much of the others I could possibly get. And I pray that same thing on every brother and sister who here today, that we, again, your Spirit is a mystery, but we've got to be open, ready to listen, ready to obey, ready to learn, be teachable, be usable.
Yes.
Help us to do all these things, because we fall far short. I'm not putting anybody down, because we're doing the best we can. But none of us is perfect. And we pray, Father, that we would use this great tool you left behind, the Holy Spirit, in each and every one of us. It doesn't come and go like it did in the Old Testament. it's a valuable asset. It's a valuable tool to help each one of us personally in our lives to use the Spirit to help us to grow, to help us to learn, to help us repent. You know, tell them we're all here to be a teacher, Father. We pray, Father, that nobody ever asks the Spirit to leave them.
Yeah.
May the Spirit be with each and every one of us in some way this week so that we would all recognize you're there to help us. You are a valuable tool. And may we all recognize at some point that your Spirit is right there. And may the lights come on. May the lights start flickering in our minds and our bodies and our souls about what you're trying to accomplish with each and every one of us. This is not a game. Heaven is real, but so is hell. That hell will be loud. You will not be shaking anybody's hand. You will not be, you know, enjoying yourself. It's going to be loud. People are going to think of the worst pain you've ever been in your life, and it's not going to stop. It's not. And I will pray that with nobody. Not at all. Brother Jim was the one that enlightened me to this truth about how loud it was going to be in hell. I don't know if I'm just sensitive because of my ears problems or what. But that's not the, that's not where I want to hear it for the rest of my life. If they ain't got enough of a risen man looking at Lazarus, the one to tell his brothers and stuff about God. And, you know, the worst part about it, he's in hell and he's looking up and seeing heaven. Hey, coach, I don't know where he is. Father, may we all be bold for you today.
Yeah.
May we live for you. Not act, not turn a show, not cover it up. Be willing to repent, admit our sins, and help us all to move forward, to encourage, to love one another properly in new life, and guide us this week. We pray this in the name of Jesus Christ, and thank you for your Spirit. Amen.
Amen. Amen. Amen. Amen. Amen.